Right. How are you guys? We're back. Obviously, we're back. So today's lesson, mono hybrid courses. But we know how we do things. We start by recapping. And I know that lesson 6 might have been a problem for some of you. And rest of it doesn't help but myself also. When I was busy tripping over my words. But, so let's start with a recap of what lesson 6 was all about, right? We are learning Mendel's law of segregation. In other words, in Mendel's law of segregation, we are talking about how meiosis and the separation of alleles occurs, which is what Mendel's law of segregation is. But anyway, to summarize it all for all of you, during meiosis, what did Mendel say? During meiosis, homologous chromosome pairs, and these homologous chromosome pairs, what are they carrying? They're pairing pairs of others, obviously, that control hereditary characteristics separate from each other, and thus each gamete produced will receive only one allele of a gene pair for each gamete. So that when reproduction, fertilization occurs, then you now have two alleles that will make up a gene pair, that will make up the genotype for a particular hereditary characteristic. And then we know that this is now called Mendel's law of segregation, right? In the previous lesson, we learned using the characteristic of height, ITP plants. In ITP plants, we say that if you look, and we're using a heterozygous genotype. Remember what I said, if it is the dominant trait, the mark that you put has to be thicker, and then the recessive one has to be smaller, right? And then we say that this is in a cell, a somatic cell, that is found in the germinal epithelium. Reproduction. Right, and then we are having, okay, this is P, so none of that, but you get what I mean. So we are having this somatic cell, and then it undergoes DNA replication. Now, this somatic cell, we are only focusing on the one characteristic, which is height in P plants. Otherwise, obviously, this somatic cell has a lot of other homologous chromosome pairs that have their own things. Are we together? But we're simplifying. So, this has got the two chromosomes of one homologous chromosome pair. Now, before this cell undergoes meiosis, we know this in term one, that it undergoes what? DNA replication. So what did we start with? Two cells. Two chromosomes, sorry. Of what? A homologous chromosome pair. Undergoes DNA replication. Let's go to DNA replication. And then each chromosome, will replicate. So if this one replicates, then you got one chromosome, that now has two identical units called sister chromatins that are joined together at the centromere. So this chromosome has become this chromosome after what? DNA replication, right? This chromosome undergoes DNA replication, and then you have this, the same chromosome but having an identical unit that is called the sister chromatid. And the sister chromatids are attached together at the central male. How many chromosomes do we have here?
Two.
How many homologous chromosome pairs?
One.
What characteristics, how many characteristics are we looking at here?
One.
Which characteristic? Height in P plants.
So, two chromosomes of a homologous chromosome pair undergoes DNA replication,
and what are you left with? Two chromosomes again of what? One homologous chromosome pair. What's the difference now?
Before DNA replication and after DNA replication, each chromosome
now has sister chromatids, and they are attached together at a central
male. I hope you got that. Now, then we can now go, and we did this in term one. Then we undergo meiosis one. Meiosis one will give us what? Meiosis one will give us two cells.
And we know that meiosis is a reduction division, cell division. So we know that we are moving from a diploid condition of chromosomes to a haploid condition of chromosomes. So in other words, to simplify it, in meiosis one, that is when we move from 2N to N, from diploid to haploid.
And we know at the end of meiosis one, we have how many cells? We have two cells.
Now, assuming, it's a dumb assumption, but it makes it simple for us so that we can move and understand where we are going with the Mendel's law of segregation. Remember what I said, segregation is what? Separation.
Assuming that there's no crossing over, this means that if you, this one cell undergoes meiosis one, we're going to end up with two cells that are in a haploid condition. So this chromosome will end up in here. Cost to say. And this chromosome, because this cell is going to split in two. And then this chromosome will end up in here. Again,
where are you? I need you. I don't know how to get to my. There we go. I need to take this, that side.
Right, this chromosome.
Sorry, give me a second. This. There we go. Let's go up a bit. There we go. Come on, go down. I'm sorry, guys.
Right. So, in meiosis two, what are you having? You are having the chromatids now splitting at the central mass. So you have this one here, this cell gives you two.
One comes this side, this one comes that side, this one goes that side, and then you have this cell giving you this. What are these now called? Gametes. Let's make them thick because this is the dominant one. And then this one will undergo the same, give you two cells. This one here splits at the central membrane from this one, and then you end up with gametes that have the recessive what? Allele for what? Height in P plants.
Right.
Look at this. I want you to look at this. What did we start with? We started with that. Are we together?
So in other words, the genotype. What's that?
What did we end up with?
This genotype underwent what? Meiosis.
The whole meiosis, meiosis one and two. And what did it give us? It ended up giving us which kind of gamete? In other words, how many different types are we getting? not it. We are getting the gametes, this and that.
To summarize, in this genotype, when Mendel's law of segregation applies for this gene pair, we are going to end up with only gametes carrying two types of alleles. One type of gamete is going to be carrying what? This allele. And another type of gamete will be carrying what? That allele. Why are we saying this?
Because according to Mendel's law of segregation, during meiosis, homologous chromosome pairs that carry pairs of alleles to control hereditary characteristics will separate from each other. What is separating here? You are having the pairs of others separating from each other. And then each gamete will have only one allele of the gene pair. What is the gene pair? It is the genotype. So that is why we are saying that if you have a plant with this genotype, it's going to only give you, after meiosis, two different types of gametes. Gametes that are carrying the dominant and gametes that are carrying the recessive. I hope you got that. Right. Let's go into Mendel. Let's keep on talking about Mendel. Now we are going into the details now. What are we supposed to be looking at? We are supposed to be looking at exam guidelines. I hope you all have them. I hope you downloaded them. You can't be you can't be watching these videos and you're in South Africa and you don't have the exam guidelines. That's irresponsible. And you're a grade 12 learner. No, that's irresponsible. Right. We are supposed to be looking at monohybrids. So we've done this part. There, I hope you can see that. Now we are not talking about crosses. Right. Let's talk about crosses. Now let's talk about crosses. Right. In our crosses, what are we talking about here? We're talking about monohybrid crosses. I think the key itself tells you. It's mono, right? So initially Mendel investigated only one contrasting hereditary characteristic or trait at a time. A cross when only one hereditary characteristic is investigated at a time is known as a monohybrid cross. A cross where what? Only what? One hereditary characteristic is what? Investigated. It's known as a monohybrid cross. I like that. Okay, let's go. Let's walk with me. So Mendel investigated only one contrasting hereditary characteristic. Alright. How many characteristics did Mendel have? That was looking in total. 7. And yet he only looked at one characteristic at a time. Right. To make things simple here, we're gonna keep on working with what? With heightened pea plants. Right. Mendel, the very first cross that he did was that he crossed a homozygous tall pea plant and a homozygous short pea plant. Just by being told this, you know the genotype. This one was what? Homozygous. So they what? The same. This one was what? Homozygous. So they what? The same. So this means that if this one was tall, it must have been carrying what? The tall allele. And because it is homozygous, it means that the genotype is the same. The alleles are the same. This one here, homozygous,
short. They are the same. But this P plus J is what? It's short. Because it's short and they're the same, the two others are the same type. So you get the two.
In other words, to simplify it for you, Mendel took two P plants. Homozygous for that. And now the question is this. How did Mendel know that it was homozygous? Because he had allowed this pea plant to self-pollinate. Allow it to self-pollinate many times and see what the offspring are. If all the offspring of this pea plant, after being allowed to self-pollinate, come out all tall, then definitely we know that this pea plant here can only be carrying one type of genotype, which is that. Because all the offspring are coming out of. How did you know that this pea plant here was homozygous? Short. Simple. What did you do? You allowed this short pea plant to what? To self-pollinate. Self-pollinate. No one else involved. No other plant involved. Allow the pollen from one flower of the pea plant to land on the stigma of the same flower. No external factors. And if all the offspring, after repetition, if all the offspring are coming out short, then you know that definitely this might be a homozygous short pea plant, because all the offspring are coming out short. So what confirmation was received that these two plants were what? Were homozygous. Plant A and plant B. Plant A definitely now knew that was what? Homozygous straw. Why? Because it does the self-pollination and noticed the offspring, observed the offspring. And then this one now, he now knew that, okay, fine. So this one was also homozygous, what? Short. Why? Because he had allowed self-pollination to okay, and then he noticed that all the offspring were coming out, what? The way they were coming out. So he now has confirmation that this one is homozygous short, and then this one is homozygous short. Now the question is this. Mendel wanted to see from the tall and the short, which one is dominant over the other. If you are to take a pea plant that is tall, and a pea plant that is short in their homozygous state, both of them, which one of the two alternative forms, tall and short, which one is going to be dominant over the other? I hope you get that. I hope you get that. Right. How do you do a course? My power went that side. I don't want it that side. I want it this side. Because I'm left-handed. Let's see. I wanted to come this side, and he doesn't want to come here. Okay, it's fine. I'll sort it out to another lesson.
Right. Now we now know why we were focusing on this whole thing. Actually, I won't even remove it. I'm going to stay with it. Let's stay with it. Let's stay with it. Right. Walk with me. What did Mendel cause? A homozygous tall people. And a homozygous short pea plant. So Mendel took a tall pea plant. The very first thing that you do when it comes to your courses is you write your key. You can't just start writing stuff and we don't know where they're coming from. If capital letter T is for tall, write it, and then small letter T is for short. I don't like anything like that. I'm a paranoid guy. So I would rather write tall people. But you really don't write. And short. And short Implant. What did Mendel lose? So your key is there, it's sorted.
The very first thing you're supposed to do in anything, because we don't know. If you just start drawing the cross, we don't know what the T is for, huh?
We don't know. We don't know. Right. Walk with me. Mendel took a toe implant. And what did you do?
He crossed it
with a short implant. So toe implant and a short implant. And we call this our P1.
If I say tall or short, what am I talking about? I'm talking about the phenotype. That's what I'm describing.
So this is P1,
the first parental generation.
So P1, phenotype. Sorry, I don't have space.
The P1, phenotype. What happened? Where did my thing go? Yes. Let's use a new page.
I think it's acting up right. So you go, that's P, that is allo. What? So, fine. I won't do this in every lesson, but you should not forget it. Then allo for short implant. What did Mendel initially cross? Mendel initially crossed a tall implant
and crossed it
with a short implant. Short implant. This is your first parental phenotype. I don't have space. What can I do? Let's pull this stuff down. How about that? Yeah, I think that would make sense. There we go. There we go. Right, I hope that is more clear now. So short pin plants and short pin plants. Ooh. Right. And then this is your P1 generation. You don't even have right generation. It's just that I'm used to it, you know? So P1 generation what? Phenotype. How do I place the phenotype? It's the way we call it now. That's a tall pea plant, that's a short pea plant. We don't know the genotype from this description. So we know that it is the what? The phenotype. And then after the phenotype, the P1 phenotype, then you go to your P1 generation what? Genotype. Because Mendel already told us that he was crossing homozygous tall and homozygous short. Then we go and we write the genotype. Because it was homozygous what? Tall. Cross with the what? Homozygous what? Short. And then what you have is your P1 generation what? Genotype. Then we're good to go. Right. Walk with me. What does Mendel's law of segregation say? Remember, we talked about Mendel's law of segregation. So, we know that this genotype is actually a gene pair. This is a gene pair. This is a gene pair. These are two different plants. One is tall, the other one is short. This, if we look at this genotype, this one here, for this tall pea plant, we know that it is a gene pair of a genotype that is being found on homologous chromosome pairs. This is a gene pair. So we know that they have to undergo what? They have to undergo meiosis. So that will make the gametes. Are we together? So this genotype and this genotype undergo what? Meiosis. So the next line here in the center there, you write what? Meiosis. Because we have done Mendel's law of segregation, we know that from this gene pair, this genotype here, with a gene pair of two alleles, we know by Mendel's law of segregation that at the end of meiosis, each pair of the gene pair will end up in separate gametes. Therefore, this during meiosis will split and we end up with a gamete like that, and we end up with a gamete like that. Here, we end up with a gamete like that, and we end up with a gamete like that. And then these are our gametes. Hope you understand. Here's the thing. These two are the same. Mommy told me to keep it simple. They are the same. They are the same. Let's use math. Simple proportion. Let's take one. We'll simply be same. Because they're giving us the same thing. Same thing here. They're giving us the same allele, the same type of allele. So why should we give it two? So that we score a heads up? No. Let's keep it nice and simple. They are the same. Move on. Why kill ourselves? They're giving us the same gametes, that's what I'm trying to say. Right. And then these two are going to what? Are going to cross. In other words, these two gametes during reproduction are going to end up fertilizing and fusing together.
This one will meet that one. What do we call this process? Where two gametes fuse together. Fertilize. And then what are you left with? With a new plant. And this new plant is what? The genotype. That it is a new plant. It is an offspring. This becomes your first filial. You don't have to write that, you just have to write F1 generation genotype. And what is the phenotype? It is heterozygous what? Tall. But we can already see that it is heterozygous. You don't have to like heterozygous. The phenotype is actually small. But if you want to write heterozygous, it's fine. As long as heterozygous and homozygous, don't confuse. You understand? You see, the terms homozygous and heterozygous are for me telling you the genotype without me saying capital letter T, small letter T. So if I say, listen, do a cross of a heterozygous tall pea plant, you know what I'm talking about. I don't have to say, do a cross of a plant with a capital letter T and small letter T. No. Those terms, homozygous, heterozygous, they are there to give you the, for you to know the genotype that I'm talking about. You understand? Without me having the hassle of going like, capital letter T, small letter T, two capital letter T's and two small letter T's. No. You don't have to do that. So you don't have to. But if you want, you can. You can write a heterozygous tall. It's fine. But you don't have to. You can always write it simplified as what? Tall. What is this term? This is the phenotype. So this is the F1 generation what?
phenotype. In other words,
let's go back to Mendel. In other words, when Mendel crossed a homozygous tall B blood and a homozygous short B blood, all the offspring, F1 generation, all the offspring were tall B bloods. They were all tall. They have phenotype. What? Heterozygous. I hope you got it. I hope you got it. That's the first part of this lesson. We're gonna go into the next lesson. We're gonna do another part of Mendel's cross, where we look at the offspring now self-pollinating. I hope you enjoyed your lesson, and I hope you understood it. Thank you so much. Bye.